praises. We lift our hearts in praise. Without a doubt, we know that we have been revived when we shall leave this place.
Amen. We should bring today's service to a start by flipping our Bibles, if you have one with you, but I'll just read from Psalm 100. The Bible here says, make a joyful shout to the Lord, all you land. Serve the Lord with gladness. Come before his presence with singing. Know that the Lord God, he is God. It is he who has made us, and not we ourselves. We are his people and the sheep of his pasture. Enter into his gates with thanksgiving and into his courts with praise. Be thankful to him and bless his name. For the Lord is good, his mercy is everlasting, and his truth endures to all generations. And let God's people say, amen. Having read the Bible text of today, I would like to welcome everybody in the chapel to God's presence. We are glad that we can worship on a day like this before God who has created us and has called us to meet with him on a day like this. A very warm welcome to our online viewers. We are glad that you've taken time to join us. Sincere apologies that we could not go live last week. It was due to technical problems beyond what we could handle. But we are glad we can go live again today. So very warm welcome to you today. Today we have a very special program for us. It's going to be a very interesting and spirit-filled Sabbath worship. We have Daniel Gomola and the team, Hope and Abla and Stefan. They will be leading out with songs, some with their voices and some with the gifts God has given them with their hands. But it's going to be a good time in God's presence with their leading out. Hannah will be telling the children's story for today, and we would have Pastor Igor Lorenzen doing the Bible reading for us. He would also be having the special time to pray for the preacher. And I have also the privilege to introduce the preacher today. He will be breaking the bread of life for us. And I also have the privilege of knowing that he's been to various parts of Europe before coming to Friedensau today. He's no other than, I believe he's a pastor, Pastor James Fisher. He will be breaking the bread of life today for us, and we are sure that God's blessings will not cease amongst us. So sit tight, encourage the person next to you, and for those viewing online too, get others to watch along with you, because God is going to bless somebody today. It may be you, it may be me, it may be somebody by your side, but one thing I can say for sure is somebody will leave the house of God today with blessings from above. And I am sure that person is me. I don't know about you. God will bless all of us in Jesus' name. Amen. Having said all of that, we would go straight to the next item on the program for today, and it would be Singing to God's Glory, STH 559. To Daniel and his team, amen.
Now thank we all our God with heart and hands and voices, who wondrous things has done, in whom his world rejoices, who from our mother's arms hath blessed us on the of love, and still he sounds today. Oh, may this bounteous God through all our life be nearer,
let peace so cheer us and keep us in His grace and guide us when perplexed and free us from all ills in this world and the next. Oh, present thanks to God, the Father now be given, the Son and Him who reigns with them in highest heaven, the one eternal God, whom earth and heaven adore. For thus it was, is now, and shall be evermore.
Amen.
Amen. In every service, we have a time where God speaks to us through the vessel He has chosen, a vessel unto honor. I'd earlier introduced him, and of course will still be introduced in the later part of the service. But there comes a time in the service where we have the privilege to talk to God as to a father and as to a friend. And now is the time to talk to God in prayer. Today, we will not be praying for ourselves. Today, we're going to be praying for people that we know that are currently struggling with their health, their lives. I shared in the Sabbath school of someone who still had to come on air but was struggling with brain tumor. I know we know a lot of people who are struggling with something that is unbearable. Of course, we know it's a fallout of the sin that we have to go through some of these difficulties. But let's take time out this morning to remember that person that you know personally and somebody maybe you don't know personally. But take time to pray for them. It's a painful thing. It's a painful crucible that people have to go through these, but it's a reality that we are faced with every day. And God has called us to be our brothers' keepers and sisters' keepers too. Let's take time out this morning to pray for the sick. It could be you, but somebody's praying for you. You also pray for somebody. This morning, I'll give us 2 minutes to take time to talk to God about a friend, a sister, a brother, a neighbor, someone you know who is struggling with his health. After which I'll wrap up in prayer. Let us pray. As we pray, let us remember those struggling for health, even their lives at the senior home, very close to us here, that God will please stretch forth His healing hands to them, and they will receive healing from Him this morning. Let us begin to wrap up our prayers, believing that God has heard us this morning.
And so, Heavenly Father, thank you very much for this day. Thank you for the privilege of prayer. Thank you for the grace you have bestowed upon each one of us to experience the sunrise of each day and even the sunset, to experience different weathers, the summer, the winter, spring, and everything you've given us to make our lives beautiful. We do not take these for granted, and that's why we have come with our hearts this morning to say thank you, Father, for this very privilege that you've given to us. We pray for forgiveness of sins, O God. We are sinners in dire need of your grace. We pray that you please have mercy upon us, that these sins of ours will not serve as a hindrance to the prayers said this morning. We have taken time out to pray for those who are struggling with terminal diseases, one ailment or the other, maladies that people feel they don't deserve. But that's what they are going through. And Lord, you are very much aware of the situations. We pray, O God, that you will please send forth your healing hand upon them. Let there be healing. First and foremost, spiritual healing. Let them be at peace with you. And Lord, if it so pleases you, you also grant them physical healing. That testimonies will be their experience, O God. Lord, you will do this for us, and we will glorify you continually. You are the great physician, the sympathizing Jesus. You heal at your word, at the pronouncement of your word, healing goes forth. So please, Father, those in the chapel today, those outside of the chapel, within Friedensau, outside of Friedensau, those watching us via our online platform, I pray, O God, that for whatever healing that is desired, be it spiritual healing, physical healing, financial healing, Lord, it's not more than you can do. Please, wrought this healing in our lives. And glory, honor, adoration will be ascribed unto you every day of our lives. Thank you, because today's program will be a success. You will minister amongst us and our lives will be transformed. In a special way, I commit the preacher into your care. You will fill his mouth with words from the throne of grace, and every word he utters will administer peace to the hearts of everyone here and our online viewers. Blessed be unto your holy name, O Father, for we pray all of this knowing that Jesus has heard us. Amen. Amen. Now is the time to take some announcements. We have just a couple of announcements this morning. We just want to give a gentle reminder. Every time we are singing a congregational song, we would encourage the congregation to please use your nose mask when singing. And we're just still trying to manage the COVID situation. We pray that in the shortest possible time, it will become a thing of the past. But in the meantime, please use your nose mask when singing. When the service is over, the doors we have here and there would have people standing there to help collect the tithe we're returning to God and our offerings. Please, if you have yours with you, don't go back home with them. Feel free to drop them in the basket with the ushers that will be standing there. Today, we don't have children's story, but I'm told to share with someone, the preacher, if you have a kid story, feel free to call the kids out and tell them something that can encourage them. But if not, we believe God's word will still speak to them, because we are all God's children. Whether young, adult, the word will still minister unto them. So that's what I was told to tell the preacher. And right now we would go into the next singing session. We would have... Yeah, before we go into the song, the church university pastor has an announcement, and we have to allow him. Thank you.
Thank you. A quick announcement. Next week, next Sabbath, we have something that, in the words of the Lord of the Rings, hasn't happened in an age. We have communion service with foot washing. Okay, I expected a slightly more enthusiastic reply, response to that. That also means we have a bit more preparation and aftercare for that, because foot washing involves basins and water and so forth. And so the way we plan this for next week is we will have the German service at 9:30 in the morning. There will not be a German Bible study. There won't be Bible study groups. So the service will run longer than the usual 10:30, but will end in good time before 11:30, because at 11:30, our service here will begin, and it will include the communion service with foot washing. If you, while I was speaking, have received word from the Holy Spirit or feel otherwise encouraged to help next week, then please see me after the service. More hands make light words, many hands make light work. Been in Germany for too long. And that is true. And so the more hands we have, the lighter the work will be for everybody. So if you want to assist next week with the communion service, then please see me after the service. And now, may God bless you this morning as we worship Him in spirit and in truth.
Amen. Thank you very much. I'm just reminded to let the congregation know that after we've been fed with the spiritual food today, there is going to be potluck at Stutz by 1 p.m. today. So feel free to be a part of it. Everyone is welcome. Bring what you have, and we will eat with love. Thank you, and God bless you. Now over to the singing team.
There shall be showers of blessing. This is a promise of love. There shall be seasons refreshing, sent from the Savior above. Showers of blessing. Things we need. Mercy draws round us falling, but for the showers we bleed. There shall be showers of blessings, precious reviving again. Over the hills and the valleys, sound of abundance of rain, showers of blessing, showers of blessings we need. Mercy drops round us falling, but for the showers we plead. There shall be showers of blessings, send them upon us, O Lord. Grant to us now a refreshing, come and now honor thy word. Showers of blessings, showers of blessings we need. Mercy drops round us falling, but for the showers we plead. There shall be showers of blessings, Oh, that today they might fall. Now as to God we confess, sing. Now as on Jesus we call. Showers of blessings, showers of blessings we need. Blessed rose around us are falling, but for the showers we bleed.
Good morning. Could all the children please come to the front? Wow, this is lovely. Happy Sabbath, children. Is it okay if I quickly ask your names? Because I don't know you and you don't know me. So, you're Daniel. Hi, Daniel. Abraham, nice to meet you. What's your name? Lila, love your dress, Lila. My name's Shaliza. What's your name? Liam. Hi, Liam. Happy Sabbath. Who else have we got? Nana Coffee, you're hello, nice to meet you. And what's your name? And this is Eden. Eden's my daughter. And we're visiting from Berlin Church, New Life Church in Berlin. So we're just here seeing our dear friends Stefan and Barbara, basically like family to us. So this morning, as I was getting ready for church, a little voice said to me, why don't you just bring your storybook along in case there's a children's story? And I thought, oh, I don't know, I don't really want to. And the Holy Spirit said, pick up the book and put it in your bag. So as I dashed out the door, I brought my book along, and I'm going to tell you a story from it. Is that okay? Yeah? Excellent. And it's got pictures, so it will help make the story a little bit more interesting. So there's a book in the Bible called Kings. It's 1 Kings chapter 18, and it's about a man called Elijah. Has anybody heard of Elijah in the Bible before? What did he do? You're not sure? But you've definitely heard of him. Okay, that's a really good start. Well, Elijah had a special message to give to a king. Now, this king was a bit naughty. His name was Ahab. And he had a really naughty wife called Jezebel. Have you heard of those people? Jezebel? Ahab? Well, I'm going to tell you exactly what they were up to. They were worshipping idols. So instead of praying to God on their knees, who prays to God at home like this? Dear Jesus, thank you for today. Who does that at home? Put your hand up. Do you do that at home, Lila? Do you pray at home like, dear Jesus, thank you for my mummy and daddy? Yeah? Well, not Jezebel and Ahab. They pray to idols and statues. Imagine that. Like something made of gold and silver. Do you think that's a god? Would anyone here pray to statues of cement? No way, no. But these two did. They thought that their statues were better than God. Absolutely not. Have you heard the song, My God is so big, so strong and so mighty? There's nothing that he cannot do. Well, not Jezebel and Ahab. They believed that their god was the best. So God sent Elijah to go and have a little chat with them. And he said to them, I'm going to prove to you, Ahab and Jezebel, that my God is better than your statue God, Baal. And I'm going to ask God to make this wood, all this wood here, see the wood? Set on fire. And I'm going to make the wood all wet with water, and God is going to burn it. Do you think that's possible? Can you burn wet wood? Have any of you adults been camping with damp wood and tried to set it on fire? Does it work? No. Difficult. Okay. So, Ahab's prophets, little helper servant friends, they tried to set fire to the wet wood, and nothing happened. They were like, oh, Baal, mate, give us a hand. Make the wood burn. Nothing happened. Then Elijah poured water on the wood, and he prayed to God. What do you think Elijah prayed? Do you think he said, God, please help the wood to burn? Actually, sorry, the people that did the first go didn't have wet wood. They just had regular wood. Elijah's wood was even harder to burn. And so the wood that was all wet set on fire. Can you see in the picture? Yeah, the wood's burning. So they were like, what? How did that happen? Oh, God didn't do that. And still Elijah wasn't finished. He had one more miracle to show them. So he said, God is going to make it rain now. Is that possible, do you think? Who thinks God could make it rain? Put your hands up. Yeah, definitely. Why is that? Because our God is so big. Okay, so the sky was blue and nice, and they were all like, no way is that going to happen. But then the clouds went dark and gray, and the rain poured down from the sky. And all the people were like, oh my gosh, and it was thundering, like, how did that happen? Who did that? And they're like, my God is great, and there's nothing that he can't do. Okay? So, if you serve a powerful God, when you've got problems, who are you going to ask to solve them? Have you got any ideas? Who are you going to ask, Eden? God, exactly. If you're at school and you've got trouble in the classroom, someone being a bit yucky to you, how are you going to fix it? You're going to ask God. Excellent. Who are you going to ask? If you've got a problem, maybe you want, like, I don't know, a nice holiday, or someone at school's not being very nice, or you want a new best friend, who are you going to ask to help you? You haven't got any best friends? You do? Who? Who's your best friend? Abraham? This guy? Your best friends? Why didn't you say anything? Is he your best friend? So if you want to be best friends forever, you've got more? You're a bit popular, aren't you? Wow. You're super popular. Am I now your friend? Am I one of your friends now? And now me? Okay, we'll have a chat after church. We'll sort something out. Okay, have I got a prayer warrior that would like to say a prayer for me today? Anyone? Okay, well done. Come on, Eden. You can read this prayer here for me. Come on. So you're going to close your eyes, and then we're going to say a little prayer. And Eden's going to read it from the book for me. There you go. The prayer's in blue.
Our Father and God, thank you that you are so strong and so good to us. Amen.
Amen. Okay, you can go back to your seats now. Thank you, children.
It is my privilege today to introduce our speaker for today, distinguished professor of Old Testament and archaeology, Professor Dr. James Fisher, coming with his wife Anne from Walla Walla University in the United States. His education started at Pacific Union College, And during that time, he had the privilege to spend 1 year at Avondale College in Australia, and also to work as student missionary for one year in Osaka in Japan. After his graduation, he followed the call to pastor in Southern California, where he also studied public health at Loma Linda University. After that, he followed the call to serve in Taiwan. So he spent 15 years at Taiwan Adventist College. So if any of you would like to improve your Chinese or Mandarin, please speak to Professor James Fisher after the sermon. After his years in Taiwan, he followed the call to Andrews University. He did his doctorate in Old Testament and archaeology there, and he was teaching also Hebrew. I was sitting in his Hebrew classes in the year 2000 at Andrews and was privileged to learn some Hebrew with him. He also participated for 9 times at archaeological digs in Jordan and has collected a lot of experience in the area of archaeology. In the year 2004, he followed the call to Walla Walla University, where he served until his retirement as professor. And as a family, Anne and James Fisher, they have 2 sons and 4 grandchildren. His wife, and she was also working as editor of Lake Union Herald, and here is the latest edition of that distinguished publication of our church in the United States. So we are ready to listen to the Word of God, and before that we want to read the scripture reading for this morning, found in Isaiah chapter 49. We are reading verses 14 and 15. But Zion said, "The Lord has forsaken me. The Lord has forgotten me. Can a mother forget the baby at her breast and have no compassion on the child she has born? Though she may forget, I will not forget you, says the Lord Almighty." Let us pray. Our Heavenly Father, thank you for your word this morning. Please speak to us through Professor Fisher and touch our hearts, and we are ready to receive your word and to work and to live according to your will. We pray in the name of Jesus. Amen.
Thank you, Igor, and it's a privilege to be here with you at Friedensau University. I've heard about this school for many years. Actually, I first heard about it over 50 years ago when I was a student at Andrews University at the seminary there. And one of my professors was Professor Dr. Siegfried Horn. How many of you have heard of Dr. Horn? 1, 2, 3, 4. So many of this group here have not heard of Dr. Horn. Perhaps I should just give you a brief introduction to him. He was born in Germany in 1908. And attended school here at Friedensau University, at least for some time. Eventually, I think he went to Newbold College in England. He married a woman from Holland and served as a missionary in the Dutch East Indies, modern Indonesia, for a number of years. And then World War II broke out. And of course, being of German descent, living in a Dutch-ruled country, he was immediately imprisoned in 1940, and he served in prison for 6.5 years. First in Indonesia, and then was eventually moved to India, where he finished his imprisonment there 6.5 years later. But Dr. Horn was one who didn't let time pass without making some effort to improve himself. He'd been interested in archaeology and history for many years, and during his time of imprisonment, his wife was able to bring a number of books, reference books to him. And he studied and had classes for other missionaries and expatriates who had been imprisoned with him. And if you have read any of the articles in the Seventh-day Adventist Bible Commentary, some of the introductory articles about the backgrounds of Old Testament and some of the Old Testament books, a number of those were written by Dr. Horn. And when did he write them? Many of them were composed originally during his time of imprisonment in Indonesia. Eventually, he was released from prison and immigrated to the United States, finished his bachelor's degree actually at Walla Walla College, went on to study at the University of Chicago, eventually taught at Andrews University at the seminary where I was his student, and contributed to many of the archaeological excavations in the country of Jordan. So Dr. Horn has his own experience of how God was with him during that entire time of imprisonment, enabled him to contribute much to the improvement of Adventist scholarship and contributing to the Bible dictionary as well as the Bible commentary. But this morning, I want to share with you some of personal experiences of mine over the past number of years. I'd actually like to share three incidents that happened on three different continents, each of them separated by about 40 years of time. And I want to use these to illustrate how God cares for us. And each one will have a slightly different emphasis. The first one is going to emphasize how God cares for us even when others fail us, when no one seems to care, even when we may have been abandoned. And I'm reminded of the words that Igor read for us in our scripture reading this morning from Isaiah, and we'll read them again. That says, Zion said, "The Lord has forsaken me. The Lord has forgotten me." And then he asked the rhetorical question, "Can a mother forget the baby at her breast and have no compassion for the child she has born? Though she may forget, I will not forget you." And then he continues saying, "See, I have engraved you on the palms of my hands." So scene number one that I'd like to share with you that illustrates this particular text happened in the city of Los Angeles in California in the United States. The year was 1939, winter time, January of 1939. A young medical doctor who had recently graduated from medical school at Loma Linda University, and that school at that time was known as the College of Medical Evangelists. It was in the days when doctors still made house calls in the United States. I don't know if they still do that in Germany, but in the United States, you very seldom would find a doctor that would leave his office to go out and visit. But in those days, that was still common. In the area around the hospital where this young doctor was doing his internship, a number of poor families lived, and so they would often make house calls to try and help young mothers who had just given birth. And so this young doctor had been out late at night visiting in the home of one of these patients. On his return to the hospital, he noticed at the side of the hospital, underneath one of the bushes, was a bundle of newspapers. And just like Moses, when he saw the burning bush, was attracted to it and went over and investigated, well, this young doctor went over to the bush beside the entrance to the hospital. The hospital, by the way, was the Adventist hospital, named after Ellen White. It's called the White Memorial Hospital in Los Angeles. And as the young doctor went over to the bundle of newspapers, he investigated a little more closely and discovered that inside, wrapped in a shawl, a white shawl or blanket, was a young baby girl, a newborn baby girl that had just been left there by a mother who felt that she probably couldn't provide for her. So the young doctor picked up the bundle of newspaper with the baby girl in it and took it inside. They warmed the little infant and carried her to the nursery where she was warmed and fed. And later, they took pictures of this young baby girl with the medical doctor holding her, and they were published in the newspapers around that time in Los Angeles, the major newspapers. And so this experience reminds us or raises some questions in our minds that we might ponder for a moment. Can a mother forget her nursing infant and leave it beside a hospital door? Did God care for this young newborn child? And maybe another question we might ask, how do I know these particular details? And what happened to the baby after it was abandoned there on the hospital steps? Well, let's fast forward 18 years to the year 1957. My father, who happened to be that young medical doctor, was now living in Northern California, where I lived as a young lad. My mother happened to be shopping at a store in town when the manager of the store and the owner turned to my mother and asked her, "Do you know a young woman by the name of Jan Jordan?" And my mother said, "No, should I?" And the store owner replied, "Well, you should. Your husband found her when she was just a baby girl abandoned in bushes by the hospital door." This is 18 years later. This young woman has now matured, and she's a freshman, a college freshman in Southern California. And she was a classmate of the manager of the store that my mother was talking to at that time. The young girl had been adopted by a religious family and is now curious about her early roots, where she had come from. She discovered that the doctor who had found her was living in a town called Tracy, California, in Northern California. And so she reached out to this classmate and asked her, "Do you know this Dr. Fisher in California, in Northern California?" And thus she made contact with my mother. Actually, my father still didn't know about this contact. And to make a long story short, eventually my father and that young woman now were reunited on a national television program. It was a popular TV program in the 1950s known as Art Linkletter's House Party. Often they would have guests that would come and they would introduce them and tell stories about interesting parts of their background. So my father was sitting on one seat, and next to him on the aisle was this young woman. My father didn't know she was there at all. And the host of the program walked up the aisle and turned to this young woman and asked her, "Do you know this man sitting next to you?" And then he proceeded to introduce them and tell the background to their story. So that's how I happened to know the details of this program. But the story reminds us that even if our parents, our natural birth parents, for some reason feel the necessity to abandon us, God does not. He cares. Whether or not it's facing religious persecution, or such as our brothers and sisters in the Ukraine facing difficult times, God cares, and he is always there to support us. So even when we are abandoned, God cares for us. But the second scene I'd like to share with you now is an illustration of how God cares for us when the world around us appears to be falling apart, when all seems to be so overwhelming, when we can't see clearly how God may provide a way out. It seems like we're going through a flood of water or a firestorm that is overwhelming, as in the words of Isaiah in chapter 43, verses 1 to 3, where the prophet reminds us, "But now this is what the Lord says, he who created you, Jacob, he who formed you, Israel, do not fear, for I have redeemed you. I have summoned you by name, you are mine. When you pass through the waters, I will be with you. And when you pass through the rivers, they will not sweep over you. When you walk through the fire, you will not be burned. The flames will not set you ablaze, for I am the Lord your God, the Holy One, your Savior. So scene number two. It is now more than 40 years later, in the summer of 1980. My family and I are living at Taiwan Adventist College in the central part of Taiwan, and we have two young sons. Our college there in Taiwan is not in a flat rolling hill area like Friedensau. It is surrounded by high mountains, some 2,000 meters tall, and it's near the center of the island of Taiwan, near a famous resort area called Sun Moon Lake. It's moving day on campus, and this is an island that is something like 90 miles wide and 250 miles in length. And moving day is there. They used a farm tractor pulling a trailer to move some faculty or staff from one house to another. And of course, all the children on campus thought this was a great time to watch what was happening and to be involved in this special event. And after they'd finished moving, the children were allowed to get up on the back of the trailer and go for a ride as the driver of the tractor pulled them around the campus. I was sitting in my office at the time, and the campus there at Taiwan Adventist College had about 5,000 orange trees. And outside my office was a small part of this grove of orange trees. And I remember looking through the orange trees, and I could see the tractor. And it started to pull out from behind a building and moved across my vision. What I didn't know was just prior to that, our older son, who was about 9 years old at the time, had given a dare to our younger son, who was 7 years old. This tractor was kind of a multi-purpose vehicle. On the front of it was a bracket that could be used to attach a blade so it could push dirt, as well as the hitch on the back so it could pull trailers. My older son dared our younger son. He said, "Wouldn't it be fun if you would sit on the front of the tractor on that bracket and go for a ride?" Well, being young and foolish, our younger son decided to take up that dare and was sitting on the front of that tractor on this blade, on this attachment. And that's when I saw the tractor pull out from behind a building and pass behind my vision and within the orange grove. About 10 seconds later, I heard the screech of tires and the scream from our young son. I guess he had decided after about 50 feet that he didn't want to ride on that bracket any longer and had tried to jump off. Well, he didn't quite make it, and the tractor wheels rolled over him. And the next thing I knew, the driver of the tractor was holding our young son in his arms and carrying him up to the steps. And as it turned out, he had broken both of his femurs, his large leg bones, and had cracked his pelvis. But we felt that actually God had been good, because if it had been just a few inches lower, it probably would have crushed his knees, and who knows if he would ever walk again. If it had been a few inches higher, it probably would have crushed his internal organs, and perhaps he would have been killed. But as it turned out, we took him to a local hospital where they did x-rays and confirmed that he had these broken bones. A fellow staff member there at the college had a station wagon. This is kind of the precursor that came before SUVs and before vans, but it was an old-time station wagon. They made a bed for our son in the back of it and had this IV inserted into his arm. And we drove 6 hours north to the Adventist Hospital in the capital city of Taipei, where he stayed for the next 2 months recuperating from these injuries. That was going through the flood. That was scene number one. Scene number two, you remember Isaiah talked about the flood, and secondly talked about what? The fire. So 3 months later, same location. This time, an incident regarding my parents-in-law. We had just a few students on our campus that needed elementary education, and so my mother-in-law, my wife's mother, was a trained teacher, and so the union invited her to come and have a small homeschool on our campus to teach our two children. They had been there 1 year, we're planning to stay for 2 years, but at the end of the summer, my father-in-law in the evening suffered a severe stroke. It ended up he was pretty much totally paralyzed. So again, this same missionary friend used her station wagon to transfer my father-in-law north again, 6 hours to the Adventist hospital in Taipei. And there they spent a few weeks attempting to help him recover. He actually never did fully recover, but the union treasurer arranged for him to be transported back to the United States where he could receive additional care. But the one problem was they had to have an RN, a registered nurse, to accompany him on the airplane to fly back to the States. And where were we going to find a nurse that had the time to take off and go with him flying back to the U.S.? Well, it just turned out that one of the missionary families had retired just about a year prior to this. Helen and Milton Lee were longtime missionaries in China and Singapore, Hong Kong, as well as Taiwan. Helen Lee had actually been born in China, grew up speaking Chinese, spoke it fluently, knew the Chinese culture, and she happened to be visiting in Taiwan. And it wasn't by chance that she was there. I think it was God's leading. Because she had been requested to accompany her sister on a vacation to mainland China. Her sister's husband was not feeling well, and he had originally planned to accompany his wife, but at the last minute, he couldn't go. So the sister invited Helen Lee to go with her. And she was supposed to start from Hong Kong and then go into mainland China and visit various sites there. Well, it turned out when she got to Hong Kong, discovered that the visa that had been promised to her was not available. She couldn't go to China. What was she to do? She had this 10 days to 2 weeks time to just do nothing. She said, well, I'm going to go back to Taiwan and visit my friends there. And so she was there just at the time that we needed a nurse. She was a trained nurse, and she was able to accompany my parents and in-law and accompanied them as they returned to the States. So it reminds us again that God makes provision to care for us regardless of how overwhelming the situation might appear. So even when we are abandoned or when we're facing circumstances that seem totally out of our control, God is there and God cares. And we discovered something else just recently. Let's fast forward 40 more years, from 1980 to 2022. And this time we'll discover that God cares for us even when we perhaps bring troubles on ourselves, when the cause of our troubles lies within our own decision-making. And we'll discover that God maybe has some surprises and can bring outcomes that even are better than we perhaps might have imagined. In Hebrews 13, verse 5, it reminds us, keep your lives free from the love of money and be content with what you have, because God has said, never will I leave you, never will I forsake you. Here the author of Hebrews is actually quoting from Deuteronomy, where it says in chapter 31, verse 8, the Lord himself goes before you, and will be with you. He will never leave you nor forsake you. Do not be afraid. Do not be discouraged. So our third scene that I'd like to share with you this morning happened in just a few months ago in February of 2022. My wife and I were enjoying a short reprieve from the dark, foggy days in Walla Walla, Washington. And we're in Mexico, soaking up some of the sunshine, escaping the winter weather of the Pacific Northwest, where it is often foggy at this time of year. So we were all set to return. We'd had our COVID shots and our test results to get back to the States were negative. Everything seemed to be going well. We left our hotel and we're headed to the airport, planning to stop in Loma Linda on our way back to Walla Walla to visit our granddaughter, who is a nurse in the emergency room, the children's emergency room at Loma Linda University Hospital. The hotel called a taxi to take us back to the airport, and after we arrived and packed and got into the airport, we were standing in line approaching the place where we had to check in our luggage. And suddenly my wife looked down and said, "Where is my purse? I don't have my purse. I left it in the taxi." Well, it's not often that you can recover a purse when it's left in a taxi in Mexico. But we immediately started praying, and God was good. I called the hotel to see if they knew what taxi company they had called to have someone come. Actually, I had trouble getting through to the hotel to begin with because I didn't have their phone number. At that place in the airport, they didn't have Wi-Fi, so I couldn't look up the address of the phone. They sent me up to a Starbucks upstairs, and I had to go there to find the hotel phone number. Finally called. They said, "Well, we can't help you at the front desk. Let me see if I can find someone out, the concierge out at the side of the road that ordered the taxi." And amazingly, I think God again intervened at this time, because when we were in the taxi, I happened to look up and noticed on the dashboard there was a nameplate of the name of the taxi driver. His name, if I can remember it now, I remembered it at the time, Luis Eduardo Ruiz Gonzalez. And I happened to remember that. It stuck in my mind. So when I called the hotel and talked to the concierge, I said, "This is the name of the taxi driver. Can you contact him and see if he has my wife's purse?" It had her phone, her driver's license, and all of that. Fortunately, she had her passport with her, but everything else of value was in that purse. Well, it's a long story, but eventually the taxi driver showed up at the airport, said, "I will meet you at the point where I dropped you off." And my wife went out to meet him while I was trying to make arrangements for the departure from the airport, because in the meantime, we had discovered that we were too late to get our original flight. They had to cancel that flight because our luggage couldn't get on in time. And then they told us the bad news. This is the busy season in Mexico. It's tourist season. All the flights are booked. This is Sunday. You can't get a flight out for 3 more days till Wednesday. We would have to stay in Mexico for 3 extra days at quite a bit of expense. And what were we to do? But eventually, just as my wife returned from the taxi retrieving her purse, just at that moment, I was talking with the ticket agent. And I said, "We were originally scheduled to go to Los Angeles so we could go to Loma Linda, which is just nearby." And they said, "Well, 3 days until you can get to Los Angeles." So I was saying, "Can we fly to some other city? Can you fly to San Francisco? Can you fly to Las Vegas?" "No, it would take too long, or we don't fly there." Finally, it dawned on me. My sister-in-law, who had just celebrated her 80th birthday, was visiting in a town near San Diego, where one of her daughters lives. Two of her other daughters were also in San Diego, helping her celebrate her 80th birthday. Just the day prior to our flight, they'd had a Zoom conference, and we'd been able to be online to celebrate her 80th birthday with her. And so it clicked in my mind. "Do you have a flight to San Diego?" "Yes, they had one leaving in 1 hour and a half. And there was room, 2 seats, at least on that plane. So we had time just to go and get a bite to eat, make it to the flight, and then I was able to make contact with my niece who lives in San Diego. "Can you meet us? At least maybe put us up on the floor. We can stay in your apartment or whatever." Well, it turned out we were able to meet with our family, sleep in a nice bed, have time celebrating with my sister-in-law. We had not even planned on that, but God had something even better in store for us in spite of the difficulties that we've been called upon to face. So even when we bring difficulties on ourselves by leaving something in a taxi, God can turn it out for good. I'm reminded, however, that not always do things turn out just that well. Sometimes we face difficulties without any resolution. When I think of what our brothers and sisters in Ukraine are going through, we don't always get immediate answers. Why? I can't explain to you. I can share with you how God has blessed in my life, and to know that even when we have unresolved difficulties, that God is there with us. He will be with us. We're reminded of the text that my wife was clinging to during that time, waiting for the taxi driver to return. In Romans 8:28, where it says, "And we know that in all things, God works for good of those who love him, who have been called according to his purpose." I want to remind you of something, though, about this particular text. In the King James Version, I think it misses the actual punchline of it. It says that all things work together for good. But I think really the subject of that verb is God, not the all things. In all things, God is the one who works for good. Not that everything that happens is good, but God can bring good out of even bad things that may happen to us. God is the active one who is working, and not that always everything will work out just as we had hoped. But we can be assured that God is with us. Wherever we turn, he will bring good out of even the most daunting circumstances. So trusting our Heavenly Father one day at a time, whether it's as a Friedensau alumnus named Siegfried Horn in a World War II prison camp, contributing to Adventist scholarship, whether it's a baby abandoned in the bushes at a hospital entrance, we can be assured that God never abandons us. Or whether it's a family facing a tragic accident and a life-altering stroke, we can remember God's promise, "I will never leave you as orphans." We can be assured that God cares. Amen. I invite you to bow your heads with me as we pray at this time. Father in heaven, we're grateful for the gifts that you give to us of life and the assurance that you care for us in every circumstance. We can't always explain what happens around us, but we know that whatever the fiery trial might be, whatever the floodwaters through which we are called to pass, we do so with the assurance that you are with us and that you care for us. And we thank you in Jesus' name. Amen.
May we rise, please? Just as I am without one plea, but that thy blood was shed for me, and just as
We have now come to the end of today's service. I'd like to remind us that we are to meet by one for potluck, especially for those who are not able to make it to Mensa. We can meet there and continue the brotherly and sisterly love in eating. Thank you very much, the preacher of the hour, for ministering to us. We believe the Lord has blessed us through your ministration. Now the benediction. May the God of hope fill you with all joy and peace as you trust in him, so that you may overflow with hope by the power of the Holy Spirit, and ultimately radiate this hope to others around you. Go in peace. Amen.
Where the nations far and near shall